NASA, after 50 years, is finally planning to go back to the moon. The Artemis program has an ambitious plan to put the first woman and the next man on the moon's surface by 2024. The program includes a new moon base, an international moon station, and importantly, moon mining. The question is, who owns the moon, and is it legal to mine it? On the 13th of October 2020, 8 countries signed the Artemis Accords, a set of rules which sets out to answer those questions and set the stage for all future space missions under the Artemis program. But before we go into what the Artemis Accords do, we need to understand what this treaty builds upon. In 1967, a landmark resolution was passed, called the Outer Space Treaty. It was proposed by the Soviet Union and the USA as a set of parameters for how space exploration should be conducted. The main points of the OST are: 1. Outer space, the moon, and all celestial bodies are the province of all mankind and are to the benefit of all people. 2. Outer space, the moon, and all celestial bodies cannot be appropriated and no country can claim sovereignty. We'll come back to this one later. 3. No nuclear weapons in space. Actually, no weapons in space of any kind. Space must be kept peaceful. 4. Astronauts are the envoys of mankind. All states should try and assist them if possible. These aren't all the points of the Outer Space Treaty, but they are the main ones that we're summing up here. This important document now forms the legal basis for spaceflight, but because it's a UN resolution, it's not legally binding. For it to have an effect, each country must ratify it into its own law, which at the time of writing has been done by 110 countries. The two main ones, the US and Russia, did sign this into law at the time. This fantastic resolution has managed to keep space peaceful for the last 50 years and has ensured that no country has laid claim to the moon, and it still belongs to all of us. But the Outer Space Treaty was not designed as a comprehensive set of rules. It was designed as a framework to which other rules could be based upon it. 4 new resolutions have attempted to be passed through the UN with varying degrees of success. As a result, there is no unilateral resolution on if we can mine the moon and how to do it legally. And that's where the Artemis Accords come back in. The Accords are mostly an operating agreement between the countries that are working on the Artemis program to try and follow the Outer Space Treaty. However, crucially, the Artemis Accords state that countries can mine the moon if they're using the objects for spacefaring activities. They state that this is not the same as claiming sovereignty over the moon, and therefore are not breaking the Outer Space Treaty. They claim it's akin to deep sea divers mining resources in international waters. But others claim that these accords are undermining the OST. Russia, the main other spacefaring nation, has refused to sign these accords because they're too US-centric. The general consensus is that international law talking about mining the moon should be done internationally at the UN in the spirit of international cooperation. Even the European Space Agency, which is part of the Artemis program, have not signed these accords, but that might be because that would require approval from all the member nations of the European Space Agency. It's actually not the first time the US has been accused of undermining the OST. In 2015, it passed a law stating that US citizens and companies could mine asteroids for their own benefit. They claim that the OST only stops a nation claiming sovereignty over an asteroid, not individual citizens. Regardless of current interpretation, as we prepare to leave Earth orbit once again, these questions are going to only become more important. The Artemis Accords just form the start in what's going to be a long line of brand new outer space treaties. We can only hope that our governments and lawmakers will be ready by the time they come around. Thanks so much for watching. Resources, as always, are in the description below. And I should take this moment just to point out that I did my degree in physics, not international law. So everything here should be taken as it is. Just an amateur who has a keen interest in this topic.